October 1981, all the rest of it.
Okay.
Okay.
Nice to hear.
He wanted to be just like Bruce Lee. So he tried his hand at fighting criminals and learned to live like a great samurai master.
Howdy, Fox.
You must know Kung Fu.
Oh, yeah, I once stepped in it.
Finally, the superhero America's been waiting for.
Hi, Bruce.
No, Bruce.
Now showing at selected Odeon theaters in Vancouver and the Town Cinema in Victoria. Check your local listings for showtimes.
BCTV.
Good morning. At about 3:30 this morning, the Alberta Creek Bridge over Alberta Creek, just north of Lions Bay, was washed out by yet another damaging mudslide. As of this moment, the score is: one person has been admitted for treatment to Lionsgate Hospital after rescue. Three others have been treated and are being discharged. But a search is going on now for two people believed trapped in a mobile home which is almost covered with mud in the area of the entrance to Alberta Creek. Several houses have been washed off their foundations. The highway, of course, is closed to Squamish and Whistler. Now, in the BC television helicopter over the scene of this latest rampage of nature on the North Shore is Steve Wyatt. Steve, what can you tell me about what's happening now at Alberta Creek?
Jack, we've been flying over the area now for about 20 minutes. Alberta Creek looks very bad. It's the bridge over Highway 99 has been washed out. Below that, the railroad tracks are washed out. And below that again, one house is sitting on the edge of the cliff, completely destroyed.
So therefore, the damage is quite considerable. There isn't anything in the sea. All the damage is still on the banks of the creek, isn't it?
That's right, Jack. There was a large mudslide swept down Alberta Creek. We flew up as far as we could, up the side of the mountain. Saw lots of logs and debris up there, reminiscent of the time when M Creek overflowed its banks.
Well, when was that? That was October 81. Nine people died. No one has died in this accident, as far as we know yet. Now, I'm told there's a 400-foot slide over the railway tracks just above Alberta Creek. Have you seen that, too?
Yes, we have seen that, Jack. The tracks are wiped out. They are just below Highway 99, and it's just below those tracks where we saw the house completely destroyed. Next to that is Harvey Creek, which is flowing right now, and the people who are working up here are watching that one very closely.
The Highways Department crews are there already, are they not?
Oh, yes, there's an army of people up here right now, both the search teams and highway crews trying to clean up the mess.
I know the search team is there. The hovercraft was involved. Is it correct that the search team have gone with the hovercraft to some other location?
Last seen, Jack, we saw it still docked at the base of Alberta Creek as it flowed into the into Howe Sound here. There are also two ambulances standing by on land.
Yeah, four already taken to Lionsgate, one kept for treatment, the three others given first aid and discharge. What's your plan now?
Jack, we're standing by up here. We're assisting the search teams now flying over the swollen creeks. The weather up here is very bad. It's not a very good day for flying.
Okay, that's fine then. Well, you'll be back to me later and you'll get some film back for me before 10:30 this morning, won't you?
You got it, Jack.
Thanks to Steve Wyatt and Steve Wright, who's the pilot of the BC television helicopter, which is assisting the search teams at this latest rampage on the Squamish Highway. Now, I don't know, have we seen the map yet, Pat? Have we given the map for people? Now, the next day, there it is there, Alberta Creek, and Harvey Creek is just south of it, this side, but still the other side of Lions Bay, as far as I know. Now, I spoke earlier to a man who has some knowledge of what happened because he lives not far from the creek. John Burns lives on Lions Bay Avenue, just below the highway. John, what happened to you this morning? What time and what happened? What did you hear?
Well, about 3:30 in the morning, there was a loud thump, and we'd been hearing noises from up towards the Harvey Creek.
Right.
And, when we heard that, we knew something that would happen.
What did you think it was?
Well, it was either, we knew it was either a serious landslide or Mount St. Helens taking off again, because the thump and the vibration, the noise was just about the same.
How many yards would you be from the site of Alberta Creek?
About 400 yards.
And did you hear the slide coming down later than 3:30?
Oh, yes, the slides kept coming down, and apparently there's, I don't know what the extent of the damage is, but I would guess that there must be some slides further up the hill that they're probably assessing now, because it's just daylight enough to see.
Yeah, I know there's a 400-foot slide just above you on the BC rail. I know that much. But the line hasn't been washed out as such. What does it look like on the outside close to your house, or have you been down to the creek?
Oh, I got up, of course, and went down to take a look at it.
Aye.
Because something that serious, you want to find out what the situation is. Of course, our power went out.
Right.
And there was a big mud flow, and they were bringing a woman across the railway track, because it's the only way they could get her from her house. She's the woman that's been injured, yeah, and I guess taken to the hospital.
Yeah, there were four injured and one admitted and three discharged from Lionsgate after that.
Well, I don't know about all of that. I tried to give some other numbers of people that have got better information than I do. All I have is that I got up in the middle of the night and took a look at it, but I've been down there this morning, and the North Shore Rescue has been going up the creek looking for the two boys, I guess, that are trapped in a trailer.
Did you see, can you still see the trailer or what?
No, I don't. Well, it's hearsay, but they said that they could see the top of the trailer now, and they're trying to get into it, but that might or might not be true.
I know, it's one of these situations. It's only a few hours since it happened. Now, tell me this, the hovercraft was lying off the edge of Alberta Creek, too, wasn't it?
Well, yes, for a while, but there's a helicopter over there now that's been hovering, to help operations. But there's one house down at the end of the street that was completely taken out by the stream.
So that's one house taken out, the mobile home
cover? Another house, probably, that's damaged beyond repair, that's on up above the tracks. But I haven't been up to take a look at that.
So that's both sides of the tracks, above and below the tracks.
Above and below the track. The railway crew is there working on clearing
the line.
Their own bridge, which I don't know whether it's been washed out or not.
But the Alberta Creek Bridge was taken clean out, eh?
The highway one, I understand that's correct. Yes, I haven't been up there.
Is this the closest to any trouble has come to your house in Lions Bay Avenue, John?
No, other than the inconvenience of the power being out, because we obviously have telephone.
Good.
But we've been through this thing a few times before, and we're kind of getting used to it.
You either get used to it, or you decide to move, one or the other.
Well, no, Lions Bay is a beautiful place. I think we'll put up with a lot of conveniences before we move on.
My thanks to you, John Burns.
You're welcome.
Thanks, John.
Righto.
Bye. The 7:30 to Prince George, which runs beside the highway there, has been cancelled and the passengers are being bused. A railway official told me this morning that it looks like the railway line will be cleared. Now, here's what happened in 1981 with the 9 dead at M Creek. That, of course, is the famous M Creek Bridge, which was repaired and reinforced and a better bridge put in. And it was some time, however, before. On that occasion, people drove over the edge. On this occasion, I believe one man saw it and stopped and called the highways department from one of the emergency telephones on the road. BCTV News, and this program, of course, too, will keep you up to date and watching closely for the rescue of the two people believed to be trapped by mud in a mobile home thrown off its foundations. And we know the mountain rescue crew and other rescue people have been there. Now, Just like to talk to Alex Fraser, the Minister of Highways for the Government of British Columbia, because as I recall, at least I think I saw or somebody told me, Alex was going to be in Whistler tonight to tell the people of that community and presumably the Squamish people what's going to happen to the highway. This, of course, creates another major problem for the government in that this bridge must be repaired, and it's obviously going to be repaired by a one-lane Bailey Bridge or equivalent as soon as possible. Now, just thinking, I might have Alex Fraser here right now to tell me what the score is. So the score at the moment is that the bridge at Alberta Creek has been washed out. The Harvey Creek Bridge appears to be threatened. It happened at 3:30 this morning. At least one house has been absolutely devastated, it would seem. One mobile home surrounded and almost buried in mud, with possibly two people still in it. Well, I can't get hold of Alex Fraser at the moment. We'll talk to him a little bit later. We have, of course, other items on the program this morning, apart from bringing you up to date on the score on the Squamish Highway. And one of my guests this morning, this might spoil an otherwise light-hearted approach, is Allan Fotheringham. Because Allan Fotheringham, of course, has played a major part in the destruction of Joe Clark. Whether that says bad or good for Fotheringham, or bad or good for the Tories, or bad or good for the media, I don't know. Allan Fotheringham is going to be with me this morning. In fact, there he is right now, I'm sure. Isn't he? Is he here? Yes, he's here. Alan's here. Hasn't said a word. Also this morning, we may have time to do a little walkabout on the Europe Hotel. But throughout the program, the Europe Hotel, throughout the program, we'll bring you up to date and keep you up to date on those people trapped on the other side of the Alberta Creek washout. Now I'll take a break. Fresh from his best-selling success of Malice in Blunderland, Allan Fotheringham has spent a lot of time peeking through keyholes for the Tory convention, and one Tory, and it was not Ron Huntingdon, said to me yesterday, if it hadn't been for people like Fotheringham, and especially Fotheringham and Dalton Camp, the whole complexion of the leadership might well have been changed, and Clark might still be firmly in the saddle. And I said, why do you say that about Fotheringham? He says, because Fotheringham said, after Winnipeg, and he said worse things before it, that Joe Clark is the Mexico, the Argentina, the Chile of Canadian politics. He represents total bankruptcy. Now, I know, Mr. Fotheringham, that you'll duck away from responsibility for the harry-carry of Joe Clark, but it would seem to me quite seriously, as a fairly astute observer of the media, that the media took over the role and not the MPs in destroying Joe Clark.
Jack, if I really thought that I had the power, as you charge, to destroy a politician, a ex-prime minister, I would rush out to my employers this afternoon and have my salary tripled. I do not destroy politicians. They destroy themselves, and I record the suicide. That's my job. I'm there to record the suicide. Joe Clark has committed suicide in public. He did it before national television in Winnipeg. He's now 0-3, in my opinion. He's lost an election. He has lost two successive votes of confidence, in fact, in his party. And he will never be elected prime minister by the people of the country. And the Tories are wise to get rid of him.
Well, that's not quite the point I'm making. The point I'm making is that since the era of Trudeau,
yeah,
the charismatic politician who can always catch a football, and if he doesn't catch a football, nobody prints the picture. You told a very perceptive story about the media and Joe Clark. Now, tell me it again. It's supposed to be funny.
Well, this is a story pushed by the Clark people. Joe Clark takes his dog out for a walk in the river. Unbeknownst to him, a reporter is watching. Joe Clark throws a stick in the river. His dog walks across the water, brings back the stick. Joe Clark throws the stick again. Dog walks across the water, brings it back. Reporter rushes back to his office and writes a story. Joe Clark's dog can't swim.
That's the very point I make. Joe Clark's dog can't swim.
Well,
but you and the likes of you. Lynch was his only faithful admirer, correct?
Just about, yes.
You and the likes of you have planted in the seeds of all these little old ladies in tennis shoes whose fares are paid to conventions. And neither you nor any of your colleagues spend any time on the policies of politicians.
Here's a Tory convention. 5 days in Winnipeg, and they didn't discuss policy. They had no resolution. Here's the party that supposedly is going to be the next government of Canada. They're 15 points ahead in the Gallup poll, and there were no policy discussion. They had smoke and mirrors, fancy media productions, lantern slides, and they had no policy discussions whatsoever. Webster starring, beating up poor little Sven Robinson. But they came out of the
vein. They didn't use that in Winnipeg, did they?
40 feet high. I mean, that's really stomach-turning to see Webster 40 feet high on a screen.
I was going to try and arrange a situation this morning whereby I really insulted you and turned around and wanted to see what you would have done.
Stab you in the back.
With a ball.
I like the Tory stabbing Joe in the front.
With a ballpoint pen. Okay. I've only had one MP who's ever given me his personal assessment of Clark, and that was Huntington the other day. Mm-hmm. Said the man, in effect, was a disaster with the media, had no charisma, no personality. That's really what he said. So therefore, we cannot have a prime minister who doesn't perform. Is that true?
You can't have a prime minister who does not have leadership qualities, Jack. And this guy doesn't have leadership qualities. Huntington revealed 2 days into the convention that a year ago, he and Joe had made a pact with the caucus that if he didn't improve his support in Winnipeg, he would resign, which in effect, he has done.
Yeah, but tell me this. Would a Trudeau have... had he even made such a deal, would a Trudeau with 66.19 or even 0.9 or even a Lester Pearson, would they have kept that promise? Surely Joe was entitled to stand there and say, I met you, stuck with me.
Sure, but he's not a leader. See, what they were aiming at, Jack, at Winnipeg, the convention wasn't for 4,000 Tories. It was for public opinion, and they know that a guy who's fought very hard. He's worked every weekend running around the country trying to line up delegates. For 2 years, he's run around the country, and he increased his support by a half a percentage point. And they know that in the eyes of the public, the public does not see Joe Clark as a leader.
So Joe Clark is now a backbencher living in a rented house, you might
say. No, he's still in Stornoway.
He's not the legal tenant of Stornoway anymore.
No, that's right. And he's running around, he's muddying the waters, he's keeping Lougheed out of it. Lougheed won't go in as long as Joe is there, and they want him out. The caucus knows that. What if he hangs on, Jack, and he wins the leadership back with 52%? That's another 15-point drop in his popularity.
That's possible.
Well, sure. And then we start all over again. They should have done this 2 years ago.
So therefore, they haven't really got rid of Clark yet.
No, and he keeps painting himself in a corner by saying, I'm going to stay in this race. I'm going to stay in the race. Peter Worthington said something very perceptive, I think, about Clark the other day, and he says he has the stubbornness of a weak man. That is true.
And you said something equally damaging about him. You said ambition without talent is a terrible thing.
It is.
And you said another terrible thing about the man. You said he has no vanity but considerable ego. Right?
Yeah, this is it. Dalton Camp made this point in his book, and he's known Joe since he was 17. He worked with him. And he said the man has no vanity, but he has an ego. And he does have an ego. He actually thinks that he would be the best prime minister. He has an ego, and he has a very strong wife behind him.
Yeah, maybe she wants to be prime minister. But it's game over now. Yeah. If he goes away, if he doesn't go away, will the Tories really be destroyed as a national party if he does not voluntarily step down properly?
Sure, because there's going to be a messy struggle. Mulroney will come in. Lougheed probably won't come in. Davis won't come in. Well, Lougheed will not run against a fellow Albertan, and Lougheed will accept it only if they come to him and they say the party needs you and wants you.
I want to do that in detail, but meanwhile, what are the giggles from the corridors of Liberal power?
Well, I mean, can you imagine the sight that Friday night at the Winnipeg Abattoir of a scene in a living room in Toronto with Keith Davey and Jimmy Coote sitting there with a large scotch watching this thing rolling on the floor? I mean, here's a party that's 15 points ahead in the polls, and they're running around without a leader now. It just puts the Liberals back in great shape, and it may move Pierre Elliott Vacation to stay on.
Pierre Elliott Vacation, don't tell me he's going to stay on.
I think, especially Clark, I mean, he knows he could beat Clark six ways to breakfast.
Okay.
If Clark is confirmed, I think Trudeau might stay now.
I was going to have an empty chair here this morning in which I was going to point your ego rested, but...
You like my official Trudeau tie?
Go in the tie. Can you go in that tie? Let's see how close you can get in the tie. No, well, closer. Is that as close? That's a disgusting tie.
It's the official Pierre Trudeau salmon arm tie. I was at a Liberal convention. I was offered $50 for this from a Liberal.
I've got one too. I'll give it to you to sell for $50. Back with Allan Fotheringham after the break. Allan Fotheringham, an undoubted expert in his field. Nobody's yet been able to explain to me the scenario by which Lougheed... By the way, why do they call him Peter the Red? Where did that come from?
Because he bought PWA, remember?
Oh, yeah, when Barrett blew it, didn't buy it. He bought PWA under BC's nose.
This raging right-wing conservative bought PWA and nationalized the airline, in effect.
And became, therefore, ipso facto
Peter the Red.
Okay. What is the scenario by which this coy man, who ain't that good a public spokesman, is going to come out and run willingly for the Prime Ministership of Canada?
He's trying to do something, emulate the Americans, where, and it's not really done in Canadian politics, arrange a spontaneous draft. Like Eisenhower, right? You get the momentum going, you get the people, and Washington needs him. Peter Lougheed is 54 years of age, very successful man. He succeeded at everything he's ever done in his life. He's not going to run again in Alberta, that is clear. And he would like to get out and have a private family life and enjoy himself, make a few bucks. But he will go to Ottawa only if the party comes to him and says, you're the only man that can beat Pierre Trudeau or John Turner or whoever. And the perception is that he is the only one who could beat Turner. I was quite surprised at the Winnipeg convention, all that old east-west bitterness, you know, over the energy fight, the oil prices, and people from southern Ontario, who control the country, of course, they'd forgotten that. And they, the main thing, they're scared witless of Turner. The ghost of John Turner went all through that convention, and they are convinced that Lougheed is the only man that could beat John Turner, and so the movement has started in Alberta to draft Lougheed, but they have to get Joe out.
Well, first of all, one, Joe must go.
Joe must go.
So he's got to be, wasn't there a story last year that they were trying to raise a fund of $1.5 million to buy Joe a house, give him a car and a driver and get him to retire? Was there not?
Retire at 43, that's one of the problems. The kid has been in the back room of politics ever since he was a pup, and it's the only thing he knows, and he couldn't get a job.
Why are you being nice to him this morning? Why don't you call him a wimp like you usually do, the former Prime Minister of Canada?
That's Jimmy Coutts that calls him a wimp.
And Jimmy Coutts calls you a wimp, too, as I recall.
He calls me other things.
Calls you other things. Okay, now the scenario. Here's Lougheed, who doesn't really want to be Prime Minister of Canada. Who's going to have to kiss his robes to convince him to run? Who in the East are going to have to kiss Lougheed's robes?
First, Robert Stanfield has to take Joe Clark off in the corner and have a serious talk with him. Stanfield is about the only one who could convince him for the betterment of the party that he must step aside. I used to think that Joe Clark respected the party so much that he wouldn't do like Diefenbaker did. I mean, Diefenbaker dragged the whole party down in that messy fight with Camp, and the echoes of that are still in the Commons. And I thought Joe Clark, for the good of the party, would put the party ahead of himself. I was wrong. Joe Clark has turned out just as stubborn and selfish as John Diefenbaker was.
And
in inner politics, Joe's okay. Quite a vicious little infighter.
Stanfield asks him to quit.
Right.
Forget Joe then for the moment. Who are the people who are going to have to kiss Lougheed's robes? Is it Brampton Billy Davis in Ontario? Is it Mulroney?
Mulroney.
Crombie?
Mulroney could help a lot if he went to Lougheed and says, I will run and I will serve as your French lieutenant, your right-hand man in Quebec. So you'd have the perfect thing run. Lougheed can't speak French at all. He's not. He says has a wooden tongue like most Westerners, and he's too old to learn. So he doesn't have a word of French. If they had Mulroney as a running partner, they could really break into Quebec, and the Tories will never get elected until they get seats in Quebec.
All right, the next point in the jigsaw is Brampton Billy Davis. Is Brampton Billy Davis willing to kiss the ring of Mr. Lougheed and say, I will help you take Ontario, which you must have. You must have 40, yeah. 50 seats in Ontario to become the government of this country.
I think I can't see Lougheed and Davis both in it, one or the other. And Davis, as a good Tory premier, I think he could be convinced to help another Tory premier become prime minister.
Davis himself could never become prime minister of Canada, could he?
I don't think so. I don't think Davis, he's still hated in the West. He jumped into bed with Pierre Trudeau and the Constitution. He, in fact, was responsible for the defeat of Joe Clark in the 80 election. He went to his condo in Florida, stayed in Florida. That really helped his buddy, didn't it? And the people of in the West still hate Toronto and all it represents, the big blue machine.
It's just as well nobody overseas or even in the United States knows the mess we're in this country, isn't it?
Well,
it's comic opera.
Well, it is. It is.
All right. Let me talk about some of your other favorite candidates. Peter Worthington. He doesn't wear jack boots. He's just got them in the closet. Toronto's son.
He wears tattoos on his arm.
What about Worthington?
Worthington wants to run, but there's no chance. He's just sort of a nuisance candidate.
Why didn't Kemp have a bash at it? He's supposed to be the smartest one of them all, Dalton Kemp.
He's not really an out-front politician. He ran once in Toronto and was defeated.
Peter Pucklington.
Peter Puck. The Peter Pan of politics. He's a joke. He's a joke candidate. But what might happen is Pucklington might finance Worthington. He's got 400 Amway salesmen working for him across the country. But he went on this national speaking tour, and he found to his surprise that there was certain things in politics that he had no interest or knowledge of, like immigration, civil rights, the metric system, all these things. And it suddenly amazed him when people say, what's your policy on metrication?
Didn't you hear what happened to him in this program? No. Peter Pucklington, the 400 millionaire, billionaire guy, first of all denies that your story, that he leaves his body by astral projection and soars over the towers of the Kremlin nightly. And then I changed topic and said to him, give me a short, succinct opinion short, succinct opinion on countervailing duties. And he went, huh? Duh. It's quite funny.
He'd be better to run Wayne Gretzky.
Crosby. He's got money to run.
Crosby. The only man in the Commons who doesn't speak either of the two official languages. Crosby wants to run. He's a millionaire, of course. His family owns a third of Newfoundland. But it's very hard to build a power base from Newfoundland.
Offshore money. What was this Dalton Kemp nonsense about offshore money? Presumably the Yankee oil money backing the rebellion.
That's crazy, Jack, because how could offshore money, the secret Saudi money that was used against Joe Clark, according to Kemp, at Winnipeg, what is it going to buy them? Who do they know who's going to succeed Joe Clark? The thing made no sense. Mm-hmm. I think Dalton got carried away because Frank Moores, the former premier of Newfoundland, is a big Mulroney supporter, and he was part of the
government. I want to ask a favor of you, Mr. Fotheringham.
Yes.
I want you to release me from any libelous or slanderous remarks that are thrown at you as I ask people to tell Fotheringham why they really hate him after the break. Later in the program, we'll have some ENG film and an eyewitness in the studio on the Alberta Creek Bridge washout. Don't know if these people are rescued yet from the mobile home. But go ahead to Allan Fotheringham.
Hello, Alan.
Hello.
Why has John Turner such a power base? Everybody's saying he's the contender now for the prime ministership. This man stuck with Trudeau for 10 years. Allowed Trudeau to lead the country to the left for 10 years, was a personal friend of Trudeau, knew what he was before Trudeau got into government, and still now the people of this country say that John Turner is the savior.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. John Turner is not, and it's not a friend of Pierre Trudeau. They dislike each other tremendously, and Pierre Trudeau's whole strategy for the last 6-7 years is to keep John Turner away from the leadership of the party. He thinks, and he is correct, that John Turner, in fact, is not a liberal. John Turner is a Tory who happened to be born into a liberal family, a very prominent Vancouver family.
But he never spoke up. When he left the Trudeau government, he kept his mouth shut.
No. The party engineers and the workers do not like Turner because they think he cut and ran away when he was needed. But the Liberal Party, whose only principle is power, they would run an orangutan if he could get in to the Prime Minister's chair, and they think that John Turner has got it with the voters.
Okay, bye.
Well, one other question: was Turner effective when he was in that when he was in cabinet? I mean, did he stay there for his own personal power, or did he have any effect on changing Trudeau's attitude?
No, he had, nobody in the world has ever had any effect in changing Pierre Trudeau, including his mother and Margaret. Turner was no more effective as a finance minister than the rest of the clowns.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Fotheringham, for exposing Joe Clark, because he would have only destroyed this country. And I'd appreciate it very much if you do something about the dictator we got here in British Columbia called Premier Bennett and his propaganda garbage he's putting on TV right now. Thank you.
Well, I think you'll have your own chance to deal with Miniwak in the spring. I would say perhaps June.
Do you have a change for the destruction of Bennett?
No, the voters can do that. I would say he's only 50-50 now, the chances of Little Fat Dave being back in there.
Little Fat Dave? That's no way to talk about a former premier of BC. Don't you dare suggest that when he was prime minister, he was 3 feet off the ground saying, do you want $1 million? Do you want $1 million? That would be rude and crude.
He's the same weight as you, Jack, except around the head.
Go ahead, please. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Mr. Webster.
Yes.
And Mr. Fotheringham. I would just like to say one thing about Mr. Pockington.
Yes.
he may not know too much about politics or anything, but he does. He did on his Canadian tour spend all his own money instead of spending the taxpayers' money. I'll hang up and listen for your answer, sir.
Thank you.
Well, he's got lots of it to spend, but the thing was a joke campaign, as I said. A man who wants to run for politics and wants to start at the top, wants to be prime minister. He's regarded as a delightful loony by the other people in the Tory party.
Go ahead from Chilliwack.
Good morning.
Morning.
Mr. Webster.
Yes.
I just wanted to call to say I think you gentlemen are doing a fine job, and I personally would like to offer Mr. Fotheringham $75 for his tie. Thank you very much.
Leave your phone number. He may need it. $75 for Fotheringham's tie.
Going
the Trudeau
up.
Finger.
Going up.
Go ahead, please.
Hello. I'd like to know that considering what happened in the 74 and the 80 elections, whether you consider it to be wise for the Tories to make some real policy stands right now. And secondly, I'd like to know if you would consider Peter Blakey to be a reasonable Quebec lieutenant for Lougheed if he was to get elected.
No. Blakey has the largest uncontrollable ego in the world, and he has been fighting for years for control of Quebec end of the party with Mulroney, and Mulroney has wiped him out. Blakey is no factor.
Go ahead to Allan Fotheringham of Maclean's Magazine and Southern News. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yeah.
Well, Mr. Fotheringham, in your columns recently in Maclean's, you've been talking about this mystery MP, the identity of this mystery MP in the towel.
Yes.
Apparently, hello?
Yes.
The identity of this mystery MP in a towel. Yes. Now, apparently, my understanding is that this has created a new Ottawa verb. And to be incorrectly identified as this MP is to be miscoited. Is this true?
You must give a little background.
To be
no name, just misquited.
Furthermore,
I get the joke. I'm not stupid. Misquited. Give a little background. This,
well,
after all, is an adult program.
Well, this was during the Christmas break, and all most of the MPs were home except one MP, a young girl, Paige, one of the messenger girls, went into his office late at night and stumbled upon him in flagrante delicto, as we say. The girl, of course, fled. The MP, the twit, worried that his identity would come out, chased the girl down the clad only until chased the little girl down the hall. His girlfriend, outraged that he would go for his reputation rather than the action, slammed the door and locked it. And here's the MP running around, clad only in a towel. And if he had any brains, Jack, he wouldn't have put the towel around his privates. He would have put it around his head. See, and no one would have known who it was.
My version, too, is that he had to come downstairs and stand at the end, near the entrance with his towel going,
Well, listen for me.
Yes, thanks for the... And by the way, you've got to give the Speaker's ruling on it.
Well, what's
the Speaker's ruling was that he didn't commit any breach of parliamentary privilege because he was properly dressed for the sport in which he was engaged. Go ahead, please. I shouldn't have told that story on there. Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Yeah.
I wonder if that was a Tory towel that they had that Joe Clark threw in Winnipeg. Anyway, sir, you're doing a fantastic job. Your articles are just makes my whole day. However, sir, what do we in Canada have to do in order to try to bring him out some parliamentary reform is what we really need in this country, in that we should have initiative. For instance, I would like to have voted on gun control, metric French, capital punishment, et cetera, et cetera. And also, when people like Error Ola, anytime she speaks, people like that scare me. Like, Mr. Fotheringham, I work and I pay high income tax and make a decent salary, but I am getting to the point where I am absolutely frustrated. I'm getting fed up with working. I'm almost ready to quit working because all I do is pay more tax, more tax, more tax. They sit around and dream about how to tax us more, and the way the chief thinks she could have said, well, let's tax them by the length of their hair. Look at all the money that they've lost by not taxing a person by the inches or metrics of their hair. Sir, my question is, what do you think about parliamentary reform, and what can we in Canada do to bring it about? And I'll hang up and wish you the best of luck. Thank you.
Well, what you do is defeat the government that's in there now, and it's been there too long, as we know, 60 of the 80 years of this century. You have to defeat it and replace it with the only alternative, the Tory party. I'm no Tory, God knows, but the political health of this country requires an exchange of power.
So the score now is that Joe's got to go, and I see now that Broadbent is talking about they're saying that Broadbent, leader of the NDP, is going to quit in the spring because he never wanted the job anyway, as I understand.
Not really, and he's really lost a lot of his effectiveness, Jack, because here he comes from a province, Ontario, with a declining manufacturing base, auto workers, where he comes from, Oshawa, and all the tigers and bright young guys in his caucus are from the western Canada.
Last call to Allan. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to comment on his complete cynicism, total cynicism. I think his tie is more indicative of his mind than anything else that he could find in the country. He doesn't compliment Joe Clark on his constitutional stand. He doesn't compliment Trudeau on his forthrightness in telling the farmers off. He doesn't compliment a soul, just total dig, dig, dig. Has he ever said anything nice about a politician anywhere? I'd like to know that.
Sure, sure. It's on record. I like and respect lots of politicians. Robert Stanfield, Jed Baldwin, Jean Chrétien. I've written about them. I am not a cynic, Jack. I am a bruised idealist. And people always say, why do you make fun of politicians? And I say, if I didn't laugh, I would have to cry. And I would prefer to laugh than cry. What goes on in Ottawa would make you weep, would make a sensitive man weep.
You really love Trudeau, don't you? Secretly down inside, the fact that he's actually spoken to you makes you really proud, doesn't it?
Mr. Trudeau and I have a love-hate relationship. I love him and he hates me.
Okay,
I think that caller had something, though, really. You are a most destructive person. But my thanks anyway. Malice and Blunderland sold thousands and thousands and thousands. What's the discount rate in the Coles bookshop now for Malice and Blunderland?
No discounts. A collector's item, Jack. It sold out.
And it's still $16.95 untouched, $14.95 autographed by you.
That's right.
My thanks to Allan Fotheringham. I'm not quite sure what's next, but my thanks to Allan Fotheringham. We'll see what turns up. Oh, it may be. But Gordon Jump of WKRP is here this morning. No, Gordon Jump's here too. We'll take the other thing first. Gordon will be kind enough to wait for me. He's here to plug the telethon, the variety telethon. Now we'll take a break and send Fotheringham off to continue with his scurrilous campaigns against decent people. After the break. Jackson's just back from the disaster up at the creek, and he's at a very bad time himself. Yeah. I'm sorry to do this to you, Clive,
okay,
but seeing you here, you'll get your leg attended to in a minute or two. Okay. Freddie, you help him up on the chair.
Sorry.
Oops. Clive, you were out on the edge of Alberta Creek. Tell me first what happened to you yourself.
Well, I was our cameraman, Gary Hennyjack, and he was with a camera, and I was carrying his video tape deck, and we were walking up some of the debris to try and get close to the trailer, which had been washed away during the night. The rescue teams are in there now, searching for perhaps two missing children. And as we were going up the side of Alberta Creek, suddenly the earth just caved away, and I was on an umbilical cord with cameraman Hanny. The umbilical cord, that's an electronic connection to the camera.
Right.
And I just went straight down, and earth was just cascading all over my head. I was literally being buried alive. I thought the end had come, and down at the at my feet, I could just see an opening. I could see the water rushing by, and I was afraid I was going into it.
Just before I have the ENG, you're feeling all right for the moment. You can stay here for a few minutes.
Yeah.
Hey, what about the people in the mobile home?
Well, apparently they're searching for a couple of people. Several people have been taken to hospital. Several homes have been flattened in the area. A lot of damage.
Right. Now, we've got your raw ENG film. We're going to throw it up, and perhaps you could tell me what any of it means to you.
This is the Alberta Creek Bridge, which is just like M Creek all over again. You can see that the road has been completely washed away. The rescue teams were there early this morning. This happened apparently around 2 o'clock this morning. Several homes were evacuated immediately.
That isn't the old M Creek, that isn't M Creek, is it? No,
it's further down. Newman Bridge, which is about 4 miles south of Lions Bay, is on the verge of being washed out. You can see here cars were just rolled over like matchsticks.
And just by the way, you keep going. I'm going to talk to somebody on the telephone here just now. This is still on the Alberta Creek.
This is on Alberta Creek, and there's one alderman from Lions Bay, which is nearby, told me it's just a miracle that they haven't lost more people. It's M Creek all over again. They're already asking questions, Jack. Why weren't the Highways Department monitoring the area more closely? Because yet again, you can see logs piled down the side of Alberta Creek, old logs which apparently were making a natural dam higher up the creek, and then just gave away, washing down at 2 o'clock this morning. And there you see it, the debris just lying down on the down by the water's edge.
The devastation is quite considerable. Do we come up in a shot of the area where the mobile home is at all?
We're getting quite close to it. You can see the rescue teams trying to get in there. It's just absolute hell there. It's pouring of rain, 50-mile-an-hour winds lashing the entire area.
That's not the creek itself, is it?
That's not the creek itself.
No, that's just another washout somewhere along the way.
Here we are. Now you can see some of the homes that have been damaged. We're 300 or 400 yards north of Lions Bay Post Office here. You can see that's where the trailer home is.
Where?
It's been washed away, just off the picture. It's been washed away. You can see there where the road's been hit. The BCR rail line is out just further up as well.
Oh God, is it never going to stop up there?
Well, that's what the questions are asking already. You can see where the bridge was washed away there very clearly.
Now here I've got on the telephone, I think I've got Alex Fraser, the Minister of Highways. There's another, Alex, we're just looking at some raw ENG film on the devastation at Alberta Creek this morning. You won't have seen it yet, but your reports must indicate that this is a pretty bad washout, Alec, eh?
Yes, we've lost the Alberta Creek Bridge. It's a bad washout, Jack. We were more concerned with another bridge, the bridge at Newman Bridge, they call it. We thought we might lose it as well, but the engineers now feel that it'll hold.
People are already asking, Alex, why wasn't there an all-night monitor on the bridge with the bad weather? Because it might have got the people out before the bridge went.
Well, it's my information that it was under patrol, and I think we have gained something there in the patrol, because it was closed at 2 o'clock in the morning, that is the road, and the bridge went out at 4 o'clock. So I'm happy that our men were on the job and we didn't have a recurrence of M Creek.
Oh, you did close it at 2 o'clock. Did you know that?
That's what I'm advised by the engineers. It was closed at 2 o'clock. And the bridge itself went out at 4 o'clock.
So the only concern now is how come the mobile home was in the position to be washed away?
I don't know. It's my understanding that the mobile home would be in the municipality of Lions Bay, but I'm not sure of that.
One final question, Alec. When do you think you might have a one-lane Bailey bridge over it?
We have crews on the way with a Bailey bridge, and the road at the latest will be open Sunday night if we don't have any more failures.
Sunday night, any more failures, and of course you'll be examining every bridge on the highway now again.
Oh yes, they've been watching them closely, and they'll keep on. What caused this, according to the engineers, was not only a heavy rain, 2 inches of rain fell in Squamish, but they had a lot of snow at the lower levels that came out at the same time. They're predicting another storm today, but our engineers don't anticipate as much water from it, because the snow that went out with this other one will not be there the next time for the next storm.
Thank you for your cooperation, Alex Fraser. Now, back to you. How did you get up from the side of Alberta Creek after you were nearly buried alive?
Well, Gary managed to pull me out, and several people gave me a hand down the bank as Gary went off to carry on shooting, and I went some people in some nearby houses.
You haven't broken nearly, just sprained.
Oh, I don't think so. I think so, yeah.
Just sprained
Yeah.
It's all in the day's work, Clive.
Yeah, but you know, you're so used to being one side of a camera asking the questions, and I tell you, it sounds sort of cliched, but really, when you're almost buried alive there, you tables are turned, and you know, it was my turn to say a few quick prayers.
Sure, I know. Well, you're the guy that's always in there at the disaster asking the questions.
That's right.
Other side of the fence.
Yeah.
Good work, though, nevertheless. Go get it attended to.
Thank
and
you.
Get back to work as soon as you can on crutches this afternoon to edit the stuff for the 6 o'clock news out tonight.
Sure, Jack.
See? My sincere thanks to Clive Jackson. We'll keep you up to date with more, and I'll be back with WKRP, the telethon and garden jump after the break. We've sure had a number of changes of pace this morning. First of all, we start with the trouble on the bridge in the Squamish Highway. Then we go to that very perceptive, if a little bit nasty, Mr. Fotheringham. Then we go back to the bridge and Clive Jackson, who was injured, very nearly buried alive. But it is my bounden duty to introduce to you my next guest, whom we all know very well indeed. We're intimates of his. And his name is Gordon Jump. How's Lonnie?
Oh, how well can you fantasize?
Remarkably well, considering my age. But here, Gordon, of course, is WKRP. Gordon, you remind me of a number of kind of sleazy, indecisive radio station managers I work for, in your professional characteristic.
Well, you know, I came out of broadcasting, and the character's built around three men that I worked with.
And none of them has sued you?
No. One called me on the phone. He's now deceased. Called me on the phone.
He called you before he was deceased.
Yes, right.
Right.
Otherwise, it would have been a long distance call. He called me and he said, "I'd like to come out to California, Gordon, and see the show being produced." He was then working with the ARB in Washington D.C. And I said, "George, please come out. We'd love to have you." And he said, "Oh, before I hang up," he said, "one question." He says, "That's not me you're doing, is it?" And I said, "Well, George, what can I tell you?" And I let it ride at that.
WKRP, have you finished production of new stuff on WKRP?
Yes. The show was dumped by the network, effectively March of last year.
But, of course, we'll see it in residuals for 1,000 years to come.
It's running now in syndication, and it's doing pretty well. In fact, it's beating the network in some of its time periods, so we're kind of excited about that.
A very nosy question, seeing I'm on the fringes of broadcasting and showbiz myself.
Oh, right.
When you get your syndication reruns, were you from the very first properly protected for your adequate share of the revenues?
No, not really. When everyone in that show was practically new to the major television audience. So we would get minimum. Now, if I were to go back and negotiate a deal now, my agents probably would insist that I have a better percentage of money coming back in residual payment. But at that time, I had no protection, so I get a pittance, but it's
I was always surprised that 60 Minutes, I think, did a piece with Jimmy Gardner and a number of other really big stars.
Yeah.
Not that you're not really a big star, but you know what I mean.
I don't consider myself to be a big star.
Well, you're one of the best-known faces in North America. It must haunt you in shopping centers and malls.
Well, I don't have any privacy anymore.
No.
But I've never considered myself to be a big star.
Anyway, there's Maverick on the television saying they did me out of $5 million.
Right.
And he sued them, and I believe he lost.
I think he did.
Yeah. Now, you're in town for a purpose.
Ah, a great purpose, too. I'm doing the Variety Club's telethon for the children of the area, and that's rather exciting. You know, I was so impressed a year ago, I came up to help host with Alan Thick, was so impressed with the work that the Variety Club does here that I asked if I could join their tent, and they actually made me a member. So
that's good.
It's a thrill.
Starts at 8 o'clock tomorrow night and goes on all through Saturday night.
Yeah, it'll be 22 hours for the young people of the area. And we have three major concerns: raising money for the Ronald McDonald House, which is going to be a marvelous place for parents that have brought their children into the Children's Hospital.
Right.
Raising money for the new Children's Research Center, which will serve not only Children's Hospital, but also will serve the Grace Maternity Hospital and Shaughnessy Hospital in the area. When we're also raising money to help provide youngsters in the area with what are called the mobile electric limbs, so yeah, that a kid that has lost his arm can still get out there and, you know, lift a coffee cup and turn the pages in a book or hold it, or in some cases be able to walk that would not otherwise be able to walk. So it's for a tremendous cause.
That's terrific. It's really admirable to see a person like yourself coming all the way up to do that and becoming so deeply involved. It really is.
I appreciate you saying that.
Tell me a little bit about yourself. Somebody else is coming. Who else is coming? Where's my list of who's coming?
Well, Fred Willard will be here. Alan Thicke will be here. Some of the country western.
Tanya Tucker.
Good. Another country western singer.
Tammy Wynette.
Yes, they'll be here, and many others, and local stars throughout the area.
Great stuff. Tell me about yourself, Gordon. How old are you?
I'm 50 years of age.
You've never considered a toupee?
I've considered it, but I would probably. I feel like a phony in a toupee.
You probably would look like a phony.
I do. I think I do look like a phony in a toupee, so I've never worn one.
Where are you from in the States?
I was raised in a little town called Centerville, Ohio, which is somewhere between Dayton and Cincinnati. It's a very small town. When I graduated from high school, there were 16 in my graduating class. Last year, however, that graduating class was about 800.
How times have changed.
Oh,
and
indeed.
And you claim to be only 50.
Yeah, that's right. Things happen in a very short space of time. Look at the air age, for example.
Tell me more about Lonnie.
Oh, what do you want to know, lad?
Well, I saw her on television saying she wasn't going to do a series again.
Sure, well, that's easy to say when you don't have one being offered you. But if someone were to offer her a series, I don't think that she would turn one down. I know I wouldn't.
Yeah. You're doing much work at the moment now that
I've just finished an interesting show for Different Strokes. It's a two-parter, and the second part will be on this weekend. And believe it or not, I play a child molester.
Oh, dear. Child molester.
And it's an incredible show, and the reason that I took it was for this purpose. It lays out to the young people how these individuals operate, and it also lays out for the parent what to look for and how to handle the situation once the kid finally says, hey, I've had this problem.
Something's happened.
And it also teaches the parent what not to do with the child and how to deal with the police when they try
That's
to resolve
good.
The problem. I think so. I think so.
It's a change for television to be a little bit socially significant, although we all laugh at it.
Well, this is considered to be by a Dr. Roland Summit, who I guess is an expert in the field of child molestation. It's considered to be one of the most significant things that he has seen on that particular subject.
Good stuff. Gordon, we're going to take a break now. We're going to talk to television fans of Gordon Jump and WKRP and Lonnie Dennis. Who's the big guy with the big nose and the glasses?
Frank Bonner.
Frank Bonner.
Yeah, who plays Herb Tarlick, the salesman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, there are some beauties in that program.
You've worked in broadcasting. You've seen all of them, haven't you? Well, maybe not Lonnie Anderson.
I've worked with people who were, you know, had all your worst in spades. Well. And not wild horses would make me tell them. Tell you their names.
No.
Because they're still around.
That's right.
Who knows, one day I might want to go back to little capsule comments, although I doubt it. Gordon Jump, WKRP, the telethon, the Variety Club telethon, and BCTV, 8 p.m. tonight until
tomorrow night,
Saturday night. This is Friday, isn't it?
Until 6 o'clock Sunday night.
Until 6 o'clock Sunday night. Calls to Gordon Jump and our Webster, and we're editing some of the raw film from, and more film from, the Alberta Creek bridge disaster. And we'll keep you up to date on the two people supposedly believed to be trapped in the trailer after the break. Gordon Jump of WKRP is in town for the BC Variety Club telethon on BC television, of course. Let me get it right. 8 o'clock Saturday night till 6 p.m. Sunday night.
Sunday night, right.
And he's one of the many stars who'll be there to help raise money for very good causes.
Bunch
go
of
ahead. Go ahead to Gordon Jump.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
What I'd like to say is I'd like to thank you very much for coming up here and doing this, and I'd like to say it's nice to see people in your position as a star, something somebody looks up to, that would put their time and effort into something as worthwhile as this.
Well, listen, don't grandize me, because that's not why I'm up here. I do it because I'm protecting my future. Yeah, the greatest natural resource any country has is its young people. And if you don't do well by them, you're gonna come up sucking canal water later on.
Well, that may be true, but I still think it's great to see people that would come up and do this for Variety Club.
Yeah.
One other thing is, I think that you do a great job on the show.
Thank you.
Johnny Fever, gotta be my fave.
Well, he's an actor's actor, and he's a marvelous young man. Of all the actors on the show, he's probably the most reserved, the most difficult to get close to. When you get to know him, you find that there's a man with great depth and great feeling. He's a very sensitive man and a heck of an actor.
Go ahead, please, to Gordon Jump.
Hi, Gordon Jump.
Hello, how are you?
Oh, not bad. I've seen you in the afternoons on...
Take my word for it?
Yeah.
You enjoy the show?
Yeah.
Write the station and let them know. I think it's a good show.
Yeah.
I missed that one.
I got your picture in the album that I've got.
I'm delighted to hear that.
Yeah.
Thank you for calling and saying hello.
Thank you. What? Take my word for it.
It's a show, a panel show that I do with June Lockhart, Richard Klein, and Roxy Roker primarily. And it's the old dictionary game where one person has the definition of a word and the other four lie about it. One of the words, for example, that I got to one day was deuteramus. Jim Lang, who hosts the show, said, Gordon, what is deuteramus? And I said, well, you know, deuteramus is a many splendid thing. My father, when I was a kid, told me as a boy, he said, you take care of your deuteramus, it'll take care of you. And I said, I've seen people fold their deuteramus. I saw one guy stuff his in a shoebox. I said, right here in San Francisco, a man came up, took it out of his pocket, asked me if I'd autograph it for him, and I did. And he said, what is it? I said, it's money. And that was the answer. Deuteramus is money. It's another word for money.
Learning along with Webster. Never had that one before. Go ahead to Gordon Jump.
Good morning, Mr. Jump. I think you're one of the more likable actors on television. I hope you're like that in real life, too.
What you see is what you get, my friend.
Well, it seems to be that way. And I watch you on Take My Word for It, too. I think it's very, very entertaining.
Thank you.
I was wondering, I tuned in a bit late. Did you guys cover why WKRP went off the air?
No, and the only information that I can give you is the fact the network has never explained to anyone why WKRP went off the air. In fact, it's a very well-kept secret. Certainly couldn't have been ratings.
Would you be able to say that there was truth to the rumor that it was because they wanted to put Lonnie into a series of her own?
I think that's speculation, but to see Lonnie go into a series for CBS would not surprise me.
Mm-hmm.
She's certainly considered...
But it wasn't the ratings.
No, when they left us alone, they moved that show 19 times in the 4 years that we were on the air. Now, that's... I don't care how dumb a network executive may be, they know that that's going to destroy a show, and it should have. But we had one of the most loyal followings of audience that any show they've produced, I think, because they followed us all over the place.
Yep.
And in the process, when they finally decided they were going to take the show off and made that announcement, they threw us in on Monday night during the summer, had one of the strongest Monday night lead-ins that the network has had in quite some time. And during the summer, we never dropped below 20, and for averaged out to be number 7 throughout the entire summer. So I think that tells the network something. And when the football season started, we were still riding in that position. And the number one game first off of the year was with the Dallas Cowboys, and the show beat them against Monday Night Football. So the network, I think, in all seriousness, made a mistake. And that's an actor's opinion, but I hold to it.
Gordon?
Yes.
Yeah, that was a good explanation and quite interesting. I'd like to thank you for, you know, all the things you're doing up here. And I sort of put you in the same league as Alan Alda, sort of a honest kind of guy, you know, and I wish you all the best in the future. I hope you get a nice series that suits your style.
Thank you.
Thanks for being
from your mouth to God's ear.
Right.
That's right. I'll take a call from Ashcroft, up in the cowboy country. Go ahead from Ashcroft.
Yes, good morning, Jack.
Good morning.
Good morning, Gordon. I think it's wonderful what these telethons are doing. I only have one little concern, Jack, about a lot of these telethons, which are helping the children, and that is the fact that all the money is going into building structures and so on. I think a percentage of the money should be put aside for helping some of these children whose parents cannot send them away to certain clinics where they require special treatment. We've had several cases in the last year, Jack, as you know, where children, there was that young child in Victoria, where the parents could not afford to send this child away to down to the States for some special treatment, and they were really hard put to find some of this money.
Okay, now here's Gordon on the topic.
My reply to that, my friend, is I understand and I agree with what you're saying. And the people of this area, particularly the members of Variety Club, are as concerned about that as are you. And this new research center that will be built to join the facility of Children's Hospital will provide the type of care that will make this area as significant as any other area in the world in the handling of children's diseases, catastrophic and otherwise. And the research that will go on there will be significant. They want to bring in world-class fellow researchers. They're going to have 50 laboratories within that research center, each one costing a minimum of $55,000 just to build and equip. They're going to bring in the finest men in the area of research to handle the problems. What you have a chance of doing here is making this area a second to none in the world for the handling of children's diseases.
Okay, got to leave you there. That was a good answer, Gordon Jump. I'm grateful for your presence here this morning. You're obviously a likable fellow who will do a smashing job for
we'll
the telethon.
Give it our best shot.
Thanks very much, Gordon.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. And I'll be back after the break. There is no new information yet on the condition or the fate of two people, maybe youngsters, in a mobile home in the mud of Alberta Creek. But I managed to get the facts fairly clearly and lucidly together. At 2 o'clock this morning, the Alberta Creek Bridge was closed by the Highways Department. That's what Alec Fraser, the minister, told me. And it went out. The RCMP at Squamish have just confirmed that there are two dead in the tragic accident at Squamish. Two males, aged 18 and 19. Let's have a little look at some of the ENG, which has now been edited partially.
And
there we are at the mouth of Alberta Creek, and on the right-hand side you can see a house which has been partially swept off its foundations. And I veritably believe the mobile home is somewhere in that area. That was the area where Clive Jackson was injured when the bank gave way as he and Gary Hanney were going down to take pictures. You can see where the cars have just been thrown off their balance and tossed away by the waters. There is the devastation above. Yes, I think that's up below the bridge. And there is an aerial shot by Steve Wright in the BC television helicopter of that particular house, which is in trouble. And it's in that area that the mobile home is, in which the RCMP at Squamish.
Yeah, I copy that.
Where? 1244? Good morning, Sergeant Kelly. It's Jack Webster of BC television.
Yes, sir.
Can you give me the score on what's happening now at Alberta Creek?
Well, I haven't been down to the scene myself, but the NCO in charge, Staff Sahari, is at the scene right now with other personnel and emergency people.
Is it a confirmation of fatalities?
We're looking at two right now. We've recovered two bodies within that last half hour. They were within a trailer that had been totally engulfed by mud and rocks.
So that's two bodies recovered. Do you think, is the search still going on, or do you believe that to be the total number involved?
We believe that's the total number of all. There were two males, 18 and 19 years of age. I believe they're brothers. I haven't got their names yet, though.
I see. Sergeant Kelly, the search, of course, will go on until everything is made absolutely sure and all the survivors accounted for.
That's right. The Squamish Emergency Group is also present. Lions Bay Fire Department, and we're being assisted by the West Vancouver Police Department also.
You don't happen to know if anybody got out of that trailer, if perhaps they were some of those injured?
There may have been another trailer which contained a female lady, and she got out, I understand, and is presently in Lionsgate Hospital, along with another couple of people with minor injuries.
I'm very grateful to you, Sergeant Kelly. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye. So then it's now a mini M Creek disaster. 9 dead in M Creek. Now we have 2 dead in Alberta Creek. 1 in hospital and 3 others treated at Lionsgate. But it would appear that the lady in the other trailer is the one who's in Lionsgate Hospital. Bodies of 2 young males, 18 and 19, perhaps brothers, now recovered from the mobile home buried in mud by the washout of Alberta Creek. I'll be back after the break. The hard information is 2 dead and 4 injured, 1 in hospital as a result of the Alberta Creek slide. Now, the factual information for residents in the area is that Alec Fraser, the highways minister, you were asking about the highway, weren't you? Hello?
Hello, I'm interested in finding out the status of the rail and when it...
All right, I give you both statuses. The highway, Alec Fraser hopes, unless there are further slides, will be open by Sunday night at the latest. The railway, according to a BCR official to whom I was speaking earlier this morning, has 2 or 3, one big 400-foot bunch of debris 8 to 10 feet high above Alberta Creek. They have another shorter one 3 miles closer to Lions Bay, and they are confident that short of more slides, they will have the railway line open tonight. Today the 7:30 to Prince George was cancelled. But they hoped, when I spoke to them this morning at 8 o'clock, to have the railway line open tonight. Does that help you?
It does. Forecast the time of repair will be tomorrow morning, then.
Well, that's fair enough. It's going to be a tricky job because I've no doubt the track will be damaged and will have to be relaid. Although there have been no washouts of the bed of the railroad above the doings. Now, a call from Squamish. Go ahead, please.
Mr. Webster.
Yes.
Yes. I'm a resident in Squamish. I've been driving this highway up and down for 7 years to work in Vancouver. I've lived in Squamish for 7 years. Last night, as Mr. Fraser said, his crew was on the highway monitoring the situation. I went through that highway at 11 p.m. last night. I did not see any evidence of any vehicle on that highway at any time on my total distance on the highway. I have, in fact, very little seen any monitoring on that highway since heavy rains have been falling. And only last 2 weeks, when we've had the good weather, they've had somebody sitting on the highway monitoring M Creek with lights, and that's about the only monitoring that has been going on that highway. And if Mr. Fraser would like to come up to Squamish and discuss this, I'd be more than happy to get some people down there to talk to him about it, because I know he doesn't know what is happening on this highway.
He did say that they closed the bridge at 2 o'clock this morning.
That's right, but there's supposed to be 24-hour monitoring on this highway all the time. This is what people in Squamish were told when they first had the M Creek disaster, that they would be monitoring the highway. They just finished installing lights on all the bridges, but the lights, as far as we're concerned, is for the Joe visitor, any tourists that come through the area, if the lights are on the bridge, they don't know what it's there for. And if the bridge is gone, the very idea of the bridge lights was to warn people that the bridge was gone if there was no lights. So people outside of this area do not know what's happening if such a disaster happens, and already has. Mm-hmm. I feel very sorry for these people. That's 11 people now that have been killed on this highway, and they're playing games on this highway, wasting money, where areas that are not needed, and the government feels better to bail out Whistler and their problems and not do anything about the people in Squamish or any of their problems with the businesses or the welfare of anybody on the highway area.
Okay, fair comment. There's no argument about it. As we look at more damage at the foot of Alberta Creek, there's no argument about it that it's now a death toll of 11, and that the monitoring system, no matter how good they thought it was, did not work in the case of Alberta Creek. And thank you very much for your call. These are the films taken this morning by, I think, Gary Haney and Clive Jackson, who, by the way, was injured when the side of the bank gave way underneath him and he was almost buried alive. And other films taken this morning from Steve Wright's helicopter, the BC Television News helicopter, and whistled back for instant coverage for the people of British Columbia. At least when it happens, you know what's happening, and you can see it on British Columbia television as it happens. This is a shot from across the water, along the water. Is there a call there?
Yes. Hello.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I think the provincial government's got their priorities mixed up. Instead of spending money on Pier BC for conventions, why don't they spend some money for the people in Squamish? I don't go skiing, but they've taken over the ski resort. Now build a decent highway to keep these people alive.
Since day one, since the first construction of the BC Rail Underhighway, there have been fights between engineers and municipal experts on the fact that the highway was sited in the wrong areas and that the highway should have been above the rail line. But political considerations apart, I don't know what the government does. They can't scrap everything and put all the money into... I doubt if you can make a safe highway along the face of that moving mountain. And the proposition, I mean, a totally 100% safe highway like the freeway, for instance, from Vancouver to Chilliwack. I mean, that's just not the same kettle of fish. We want to find out, they've been keeping an eye on any dams further up, which is what they told us they were going to do. And I'm quite sure the highways department, you know, has done the best it can. But priorities, I don't know. If you put a road through the watershed, I'm told too that the downward side of the road through the watershed would be subject to very great problems indeed. But thanks for your call.
Thank you. Another inquest
will be started on the whole problem of the highways to Squamish and Whistler, and I'll be back after the break. Two young men, 18 and 19, have now been confirmed as dying in the wreckage of a mobile home covered in mud and swept down by the collapse of the Alberta Creek Bridge just the other side of Lions Bay. This follows the 9 dead in the October 81 disaster at the M Creek Bridge. My thanks to Steve Wyatt and Steve Wright and Clive Jackson and Gary Haney and Ken Oreskovich and all the news guys on the, and Mark Schneider on the job this morning. I'll be back Monday at 9 a.m. precisely. Fotheringham on the prod on check at midnight precisely. Eugene Whelan, Monday, 9 a.m. precisely.